I went onto the Sermon Central website. This is a paid subscription site that gives pastors, anybody that wants to pay, give them illustrations and sermons and things that can help them in their preparation. I found on this site what some people think about when you say the words the Easter Bunny. So one boy told his mother that he doesn't like Easter because every time he gets Easter candy, he gets a big bruise on his arm. His mother said, eating Easter candy won't give you a bruise. To which the boy said, it will if it's your big brother's candy. One girl wanted to know if the Easter Bunny ever got stressed out from hiding all of those eggs. She said it would be sad if he did, because then he would be an Easter basket case. I like the groans, that's fun. The father asked his son, why are you stuffing all that Easter candy in your mouth? The son said, because it doesn't taste as good if I stuff it all in my ears. A little girl wanted to know what happened when the Easter Bunny caught his head in the fan. Sadly, she was told it took years off his life. And everyone knows what happens when you cross the Easter Bunny with Chinese food, you get hot suey. Why would anyone in their right mind begin an Easter sermon with painful, groan-filled, bad, corny anecdotes? Because Easter is a day of joy, a day of glory, a day of celebration, and what's more joyous than bad jokes and tortured puns? Easter is a celebration because it is the day of our Lord's resurrection. Jesus defeated death and saved the entire world from their sins. Christ was victorious, death lost. In our scripture reading for today, we find that Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to Jesus' tomb. They probably went there to pay their respects, to mourn, to find closure over the fact that their Lord had been killed. When they got to the tomb, there was a huge earthquake. An angel rolled away the stone and sat on top of it. He told them that Jesus had been raised, just as he said that he would. Then the angel gave them instructions to come and see the tomb, to go and tell the disciples, and to be ready, for they will meet Jesus. So today I want to look what Matthew's story does for us or gives to us on this Easter morning. And to answer that question, we first need to discover what the two women went, what they experienced when they went to that tomb that first Easter morning. The first thing they experienced was an opportunity to believe. The angel said, come see the place where he lay. Now, I think it's no coincidence that it was these two specific women who came to the tomb. They were there at the cross. They were standing there with Jesus' mother and the disciple whom he loved. They witnessed with their own eyes that Jesus was really tortured, really hung on two bits of jagged wood, and really died. They had no problem believing in his death, as they had seen it firsthand. And now they were given a chance to see and believe in the resurrection. Because of their ability to believe, these ladies went from total despair to having great feelings of joy. Jesus' entire ministry was one of believing. As a boy, they had watched him teaching the experts in the temple. He had healed people with contagious diseases, healed the lame and the deaf and the blind. People believed in Jesus because he could calm the seas and he could walk on top of the water. He had this ability to look right into a person's heart and change their life, as he did with the 12 disciples, the woman at the well, Zacchaeus, the tax collector, and Paul on his way to Damascus. There is no disputing the fact that Jesus constantly gives people a life-changing opportunity to believe. Now, the second thing given in this Easter story is an opportunity to share. In verse 7, the angel says to the two women, go quickly and tell the disciples what has happened. The amazing thing about Christ is that his story is meant to be told. And in telling, one gains strength and confidence. Look at what the resurrection did for the 12 disciples.
During Jesus' arrest and trial, these men denied him. They ran and hid from the authorities, and they abandoned him in his most desperate hour. But after the resurrection had taken place, these same disciples shared the good news with everyone. They preached boldly. They suffered arrests and beatings. They instituted the church, and almost all of them came to them a martyr's fate, and they confidently died for their Lord. Sharing Christ with the world gave the disciples courage, assurance, and a power to live and serve in Jesus' name. The final thing we are given in this Easter story is the opportunity to rejoice. In verse 8 we read, "So they left the tomb quickly with fear and with great joy. Suddenly Jesus met them. He said, 'Greetings.' They took hold of his feet and they worshipped him." The very sight of Jesus created joy and a desire to come to worship. Jesus had so touched their lives that his presence was cause for rejoicing. Jesus alive meant that because he lived, then all shall live. His resurrection gave a purpose to live for God and to bring others to Christ. The resurrection meant that good was victorious, that evil was defeated. Jesus coming back, just as he said, set the tone for humanity. Easter is a glorious day for Christians all over the world, from the first one to this one today. Easter is a chance to believe in God's love. Easter is an opportunity to share Christ with the world. Easter gives us reason to rejoice in the truth and in the loving presence of our God. So what does Easter give to each of us this day? As we celebrate with our families, as we come together, as this afternoon we eat and eat and eat until we can no longer move, what does that give us? It gives us that, but what does Easter give us today? It gives us the same three things. It gives us a chance to believe, it gives us a chance to share, and it gives us an opportunity to rejoice. When we as Christians, I'm thinking of that other specialty, when we as Christians think of Easter and all that Christ gave for us, it gives us that opportunity to believe. When we believe in Christ, we are given a strength that was not there before. We are given that sense that we are never alone in this world. When we believe, we have a purpose that puts us beyond ourselves and our own needs. We have a peace that calms our souls, and we have a heart that is always full. That's what Easter gives us. It gives us that opportunity to believe. It also gives us that opportunity to share. We get to share Christ. We get to share our hopes. We get to share our fears. We get to share our faith. We get to come together as a community that shares God in their lives. We come to this place. We worship together. We bond together. We share together. We help together. And we are able to give each other our own burdens together because we get to share them. We get to go out into the world as Christians and share Christ with all people that we meet. When we do mission work, when we help total strangers, when we come together for something that needs our attention. It doesn't matter what it is, as Christians coming together to Christ, we get that opportunity to share that in the world. We share it with each other, and it strengthens us and makes us a family here in this room today. And we share that out in the world, and it makes us one with Jesus because we get the privilege to share. And we also get to rejoice. That's a wonderful thing as Christians. People don't always think that Christians are happy people because they have to be good and they don't get to do all the things that other people get to do. But it is a complete joy to be a Christian. But before we can rejoice with Christ, I think that we have to get that misnomer in our head. There's this thing about being a Christian that some people think that means that your life is easier, that bad things don't come your way. And we may not believe that, but I think sometimes we think it. I think sometimes when something really tragic happens, we say, oh, I've gone to church, I've done all these good things, how can God be doing this to me? How does God let this happen to me? For us to rejoice in Christ, we have to remember that whether you're a Christian or not, whether you believe in a God or not, the God as we believe or not, life is hard, and these things are going to happen to you. They don't happen less to Christians. They don't happen more to non-Christians. It's part of life. Life is a living being, and it unfolds as it will, and sometimes we are rewarded for that, and sometimes there are consequences for that. That's what life does. But we can rejoice in God because when we go through these things, Christ doesn't take the suffering from us, but Christ is there with us through our suffering. And when Christ is there with us through our suffering, we can face that pain. We can have the help to deal with that unspeakable thing going on in our lives, and Christ will help us move beyond that pain. And when we can grow from it and move beyond it, then we can rejoice. And we can rejoice in that special way with Jesus. So those are the three things. So let's put those three things into a story and see what happens at the end of today. This story is by a man named Harry Pritchard. I found it online. It's in books. It's a very well-known story by now. I think it was first printed in the late 90s, the early 2000s. But it's a story about a boy named Philip. And Philip was, unfortunately, some people are, Philip was born different. He was born with too many issues, too many organs that didn't work right, too many organs that were too small, that were too big, that affected his body in different ways than it would the rest of us. And one of the things that the way he was born affected his body is that Philip did not have the same IQ as other children his age. And he was kind of big for his age. So Philip was seen as this big dumb kid. And he wasn't treated the same because he didn't have the same mental ability as other kids his age. And Philip, with nine other kids, attended the Sunday school class. And one day the teacher said, you know, we're going to do something different. I want to talk about Easter today. I want to talk about the newness that Easter brings, the fresh start we get in Easter and in spring. So she says, what I want you to do, she gave them all one of those big eggs. Remember those big plastic eggs? You used to keep pantyhose in them. I think they were called legs. They're not Legos, but I think they were called legs. They came in all different kinds of colors, depending on which color and style of pantyhose you had. And I had them in my hand. My mother had them in her house. Make that point crystal clear. And so it was one of those great big plastic eggs. And she gave them all one, and she says, I want you to go out in the church, out in the parking lot, out in the grass. I want you to find something that represents Easter for you, that new beginning, that fresh start. Put it in the egg and bring it back in here. So they're all excited. They run out, they do their thing, they find the thing, they bring it back. And she says, let's open up your egg. So she opens up the first egg, and there's a flower inside. And this little girl is jumping up and down. She goes, that's mine, that's spring. It's springtime, we get new flowers, and new flowers mean life. And everybody gets a golf clap, and everybody's sick. And then she opens up the next one. There's a caterpillar inside. This little girl goes, that's mine, because caterpillars turn into butterflies, and that is a symbol of new life. So she takes another egg and she opens it up, and there's a rock inside. And everybody laughs because rocks aren't alive. That doesn't express anything. But this little boy says, that's mine, because if you look, there's moss on the rock. And moss is a living thing, and you get living things even over things that aren't living. So that's why I picked the rock. And she opens up the next egg, and it's empty. And some little boy says, that must be dumb Philip's egg. He can't even follow the directions. He can't even fill his egg. Well, this gives permission for all the other children to start saying all the things that Philip did wrong because it had to be his egg and he can't even follow the simplest directions of putting something inside the egg. Philip got mad and he said, no, that's mine. It's supposed to be empty. That's new life. The tomb was empty. And something happened that day to Philip once he said that. The kids saw him differently. All of a sudden, Philip was smart. He got it. He got it before any of the rest of them understood. And Philip's relationship with his class changed that day. It did. He would come to Sunday school in the weeks and the months that followed, and he would sit with them, and they would ask him how he's doing, and they would play together, and everything was going great. And a few years passed, not very many, two, three, 4 years passed. And Philip got very sick. His parents knew this time would come, the doctors knew, because his body was just so different. He wasn't supposed to last a week when he was born. And he's lasted many years, but they knew the time was coming, and as joyous as they could make it, as celebratory as it was, they had the funeral for Philip. And they had the, I call it viewing, I think here you call it calling hours, but they had the calling hours, and everybody came and they went up, and lots of people there, as there tends to be lots of people at calling hours, there tends to be lots of people at calling hours when someone dies so young. And so people would come up and see Philip and put a rose and pay their respects. And when everyone had left, the parents came up and they went to look at their son and collect all of the roses that people had laid and 9 empty big eggs with Philip. Easter is a day to rejoice. Easter is a day of new beginnings, of a fresh start, of new opportunities. Easter is a day, every day, because of Easter, is a day that we can believe, it's a day that we can share, and it's a day that we can rejoice. Happy Easter, let us pray. Dear God, thank you for this day. May the joy and celebration of this day be with us every day as we serve you with our hearts, our minds, and our souls. Amen.